siia Kimmo Antila, kes räägib näitusest Tampere 1918 ja mina võin öelda sisse juhatuseks seda, et mina nägin seda näitust kohe varsti peale seda avamist. Ja see näitus jättis mulle väga sügava mulje ja muutis märgata minu arusaamist Soome ajaloost. Ja muidugi see üks põhjus on ka, et Kimmo seda ise seletas tooga ja ma loodan, et siin praegu see Kimmo jutu toob seda näituse ja need emotsioonid ka teile lähevad.
Thank you, Peret. So good afternoon. So I'm coming from Tampere, from Museum Center Paprik, which is one of the largest museums in Finland. And it's located in this nice industrial scenery by the Tammerkoski rapids. This is actually the building of Paprik, an old engineering workshop. The oldest parts are dating from the 1880s. And the exhibition I'm going to talk more thoroughly today is this exhibition about our civil war. And the name Tampere 1918 doesn't say anything to a foreigner, but it's the decisive battle of Finnish civil war, a war which lasted for 4 months on the spring 94 years ago. And in Tampere, a city with 45,000 inhabitants, there was somewhere around 30,000 soldiers fighting with each other, and it resulted over 2,000 bodies all around the streets of Tampere. Some few words about our museum first. So Paprik is located in Tampere, which is 175 kilometers north from Helsinki, and we are marketing our museum center nowadays with the slogan, surprisingly versatile museum center. And it's really a statement that we can say it's much true behind this statement. So we have like 11-12 exhibitions annually, and they vary from local history to foreign cultures. I also have my colleague Margarita Saloniemi here, our head of exhibitions, who can also answer the questions concerning our ideology behind our exhibitions. And today we are talking about permanent exhibitions. Actually, a couple of years ago, I think it was 2006 or 2007, we made a decision that we should get rid of this concept of permanent exhibitions, and instead of that, we're going to have this ever-changing process going on through the museum. Of course, we are making exhibitions from our own collections. We have 375,000 items in our collections, millions of photographs, and we have special sections or special museums inside our museum center. One of these is the Ice Hockey Museum or the Ice Hockey Hall of Fame. We have a shoe museum. Tampere used to be the center of the shoe factory industry also in previous years. We have a collection which used to be like a privately owned collection for costumes and toys, but it's also part of our functions. And we have an exhibition which is called The Time to Play, so about toys and playing. We also opened up a natural history museum 2010, which is extremely popular at the moment, and we discussed about targeting our exhibitions towards families, and I really think that the natural history museum has really made its task of attracting new groups of people to our museum center. So, and I already mentioned these changing exhibitions. We have, I think, the Shaman Drum reflects also the Fenno-Ugric people and also these small cultures we have been made several exhibitions on. And these special exhibitions, which have been extremely popular, are changing annually. A couple of years ago, we had the Age of Papeche. The collection came from the Moscow Kremlin, this jewelry and stuff. And this year we made an exhibition called Let's Create a New World, and this excellent Occitation porcelain came from the State Hermitage Museum. And of course, we also, during the last presentation, discussed a little bit about the events and different kind of needs to use the museum space for other purposes than exhibitions as well. So we're organizing different kind of occasions, events, like rock concerts sometimes, and also we have our own restaurant, which is also very important for our income. But now I will change viewpoint more to these exhibitions, which used to be permanent exhibitions, but I think we nowadays we call them exhibitions which are based on our own collections. And this museum center was opened 1996, and 2000 was opened an so-called permanent exhibition called the Pirkanmaa region, or the history of the Pirkanmaa region, which was very holistic exhibition coming from prehistoric time to the modern days, presenting all kind of aspects to the history of this region. So, and it was in our main hall with some 900 quarter meters, very good exhibition in a way. But you could say that we also, David Fleming mentioned this problem with the city museums, that they used to be a little bit dull. They are sometimes a little bit too heavy on concentrating on these traditional ways to somehow present the history of the region or the city. So we also realized 2006, 2007, somewhere around that we should get rid of the Pirkanmaa exhibition and try to really change the concept of these permanent exhibitions in really totally different direction. And our aim was to concentrate on different kind of themes and build on exhibitions on these themes. I'm going to go more thoroughly on the Tampere 1918, which was actually the start of this project. And it continued with these exhibitions on the history of Tammerkoski Rapids or the city itself. We were also, if Tampere 1918 or the exhibition on Civil War, it's an exhibition that makes you cry, and it definitely has been proven that it really do get people cry on the exhibition. This exhibition on Tampere itself, it's an exhibition that could make you laugh. So there are like video clips with the sense of weird sense of humor, all these kind of phenomena on this, how do you call it? Is it the merry-go-round or
lucky wheel?
Yeah, that you can choose your video clip, and in the center of the exhibition is a miniature model from Tampere 1819, and also of course there's a lot of technology involved, like in ILO Museum. In previous exhibition or the presentation, we also realized that we should tell the stories of the people. That was also the one point that David Fleming made on the morning presentation. And one way to tell the stories of the people that we chose to be the one way to also to approach younger generation is to make comics out of the families that live in Tampere, and it resulted actually to a comic book we also published in English. The second exhibition, which is based on our own collection, it's an exhibition which is called Innovations. In Tampere, we had the oldest collection, and probably also probably one of the best collections on industrial history and the history of technology, which is also part of our functions nowadays. There is actually a sad history behind the Museum of Technology in Tampere. It was caught in a fire 1989 But this fire was also a new start for this development of museums, so the cultural historical museums in Tampere, and it also gave a chance to really to establish the Vapriikki concept 1996. But we have these collections which survived from the fire, and there were a lot of requests, mainly from the engineering societies, that when you're going to use these collections again and have this kind of a new museum of technology. And our answer to that was that we're not building a new museum of technology, but instead of that we are building new kinds of exhibitions out of this collection. So we built up the shoe museum, which is also representing and telling the story of the industry, the shoe industry. We made the media museum, Rubriikki. We opened up a textile industry museum 2006 together with the Finnish Labour Museum. And now we're working on this project called Innovations, which is going to concentrate on this kind of innovativeness of the technological innovativeness in the region, and telling these stories, which is actually sort of like an they have been very important stories for the city that the Tampere was the first one to bring the Edison electric light in the Nordic countries. Tampere has a marvelous history in aircraft production and so on. And in this exhibition and research project, we have also trying to look critically into these stories, like the coming of the electric light. It was not the result of the one man, but it was the result of the networks, which actually Tampere and people in Tampere were already connected during the 19th century. And it's important that this emphasize the connections to St. Petersburg, which were essential for this project, which resulted in electric light. This is a sketch from this innovation gallery, three-dimensional thing, and in all these exhibitions, we have also tried to thought in a modular way, that there is kind of a possibility to change these sections in the exhibition, renew them annually, or at least within 2 or 3 years. We are still working with this last part of the innovation gallery, and it's going to be opened this summer. And I would also use this possibility to announce or to market a little bit about our forthcoming conference on the museums of science and technology, SIMUSET, which is going to take place in Tampere late August, and you can find more information on this web page. It is also very important that when you're making almost saying the permanent exhibitions, but these new exhibitions on your own collections, that you also use some other devices than this physical space that you are building this exhibition in. You have to use new communication possibilities throughout the web. This is our own social media called Museo Solmu, Museum Knot, which is a place that you can share your photographs, you can share your historical photographs, your stories, and this is one of the projects that we've been started last year. It's about the rock and roll in Tampere, Rockia Mansesta. Manse is this nickname of Tampere, which is derives from Manchester, like we are the same kind of town with the textile industry and also the rock music. We have also tried to use new devices on these exhibitions and to do the guiding systems, and this is one of those things for Tampere 1918 exhibition, using iPads and mobile devices to enrich the experience on the exhibition. And of course, traditional web pages, portals like this Tammerkoski Heritage, which also have this section on three-dimensional Tammerkoski rapids. And well, there are some attempts to get into a dialogue with the local people, but we have still a lot of work ahead on these projects. Okay, now about what about this Tampere 1918, a peculiar project. Actually, it's already started during the spring 1918, where museum director Kaplier Engberg got a permission to collect all these objects from the streets and for the spoils magazines, and it's a collection of 1,500 items with all this kind of very mundane artifacts, also of course militant military equipments and guns and ammunition and so on, but it really tells the story how the civil war, the Finnish civil war, was the war of the normal people. And what is also very peculiar, one was also one kind of an how do you say? It's one thing that really shows you how problematic this issue has been in Finland, that it took 90 years when we got the possibility to put these objects, these items, which were gathered right after the war, into an exhibition. There were some, or actually several attempts to create this exhibition, but I think that the time was mature after 90 years has passed, and yet this civil war is sort of like a trauma in Finland. Everyone knows that whether your family was on the white side or on the red side, what happened, who got killed, and who got into the prison camps, and especially in Tampere, which was heavily divided city, and the place where the decisive battle was fought, it was very, very problematic thing. And during this exhibition project, we received some strange phone calls and some comments on local politicians. You're not going to show any bodies, dead bodies, in the exhibitions, and you're not going to discuss openly about what happened. Of course we are showing dead bodies, of course we are showing some blood on the exhibition, of course we are talking about these very several difficult things that happened during these 4 months of fighting. Of course we are also dealing with these issues from both sides. So, still like to emphasize why this war was so problematic in Finland. It's also very important to notice that on the historical research, it was also handled in a new way during the 1990s. Really, the younger generation of researchers took this kind of a new perspectives towards the civil war, and they had taken into account of the both sides of the war, and also the civilians, the child victims, the orphans, and the prison camps, where actually almost 12,000 people got killed after the war, and these are very, very difficult issues in Finnish history. Of course, the Finnish Civil War is related to European crisis as well, to the First World War, to the collapse of the Russian Empire, but it's still an internal crisis, Finns fighting to each other. This is peculiarly like a very iconic graphic photograph, this young 15-year-old boy lying on the streets of Tampere, almost like praying. And we also were trying to find out what was the role of the museum in this process of discussing about difficult heritage. There was a clear demand of doing this kind of a popular things openly discuss about the civil war, and during that spring that we were actually, it took like 90 years out of the civil war. There were also some occasions organized in Tampere, like this Wounded Angel procession, and lots of city dwellers were involved on this discussion and on thinking about what was the civil war in Finland. And it's also very important to look at this civil war in a global perspective, to compare it with other internal crises, and really to see that if there is some kind of a way to this kind of a reconciliation process, if there's a way how the Finns have survived from this internal crisis, from this civil war, and would it be a possibility also for other nations to really to learn something out of our process? This exhibition is very strong on creating emotional feelings, and it has got very good reviews and also response from the audience. It used to be for a very long time one of the most popular exhibitions in our museum center, and we received a special commendation on the European Museum of the Year competition last year. Also, this problematic issue about the concept of permanent exhibitions. We're actually trying to, at the very start of this project, we were aiming for like a 3 years exhibition, and now it's all over 4 years that we open up this exhibition. So it's kind of a semi-permanent, but we have still in mind that we are going to change it 2016 or by the latest 2018, when it's going to be 100 year commemorative year of the Finnish Civil War. This is one of the first sketches of our architect Taina Väisänen. She's probably one of the best designers in Finland. We'd be very happy to cooperate with Taina. The idea is to show the chaos of the war, to really to bring people inside the war and really to create these feelings with the soundscape and with this very strong scenographical solutions. We were also cooperating very closely with researchers from the University of Tampere, which also gave us a sort of like an academic background and a kind of a way that we can really trust that this is kind of the first, the last and freshest research on the Civil War. And we were actually writing this story or this drama in three acts. That we were actually also reading the that like Anton Chekhov, what he was stating that about the concept of a good novel, that it's actually a tragedy in three acts. There's sort of like a prologue, the real story where the war is going on, and there's sort of like an epilogue. And in the prologue, we are giving hints what is coming. So we are showing some guns, we are showing that there is this turmoil almost around the corner. It was very, very important. I shouldn't stress it enough that it was very important to network to the both sides of the war in a way, because there is this tradition of keeping the red heritage, and there is this tradition of the white heritage, so to say, this kind of an official history of the civil war or the freedom war, as the white side states names the war. And through this networking, even though that they were not actually in any way influencing what we are doing, but it was fairly important to discuss with them, share their experiences, share their viewpoints, what the Civil War is, and really sort of like, and also gave our statements that we are trying to be very cold-minded, and we're trying to really to create this kind of an new ideas to the people that I think this is one of the most important questions that we are posing in this exhibition, that what would you have done in this situation? In the entrance of the exhibition, there are two mirrors. There's sort of like a labor family home and a bourgeois home. And you can just look at the mirror. There are no explanations there. That you can just think of that if you have been born into this bourgeois family in the late 19th century, or whether it had been a labor family, what would be your fate during the Civil War? There is also this photographer studio. Actually, this was the thing that we discussed a lot in this exhibition group, that whether it's a too playful way of putting yourself into this war. But there were like young people fighting. Some youngsters from 15 to 21 years old, very young boys, and actually this is a really good way also to put modern day youngsters in this role of the soldier in during the 1918. There's a very heavy soundscape in this exhibition, and I think it's one of those rare things that we got a negative response out of the audience, that the soundscape is mainly nearly too chaotic, but it's made on purpose, because war is chaotic. You are sometimes surprised with the cannon blowing, or grenades, or rifles aiming at you. And there are a lot of individual stories in the exhibitions, which are not always easy to hear, but it's sort of like a fragments of the war and kind of a fragmented story in this soundscape. They are actually sound showers, so if you're standing right in the front of the character, you can listen to his or her story, but there is also this soundscape which is also directing you from the winter, from the early winter to the spring, and there are sounds of different kind of things from this war, from the trains, from the blessing of the flag, and so on. And in these exhibitions, you are actually walking through the street of sorrow from the breaking of the war in January to late spring in May, and most of the items that Gabriel Engberg found in 1918 are placed on these floor showcases. So you can actually are walking on these artifacts, like Gabriel Engberg probably was doing when he was collecting these items. It was an excellent idea from Taina Väisänen to really create this kind of an idea for the showcasing of the artifacts. Of course, it was a fairly expensive one, so we were calculating the budget for several times whether we would have a possibility to create this kind of an floor showcases on this exhibition. Of course, again, there's a lot of technology, which is mainly hidden. These lights and sounds are mainly not very visible in this exhibition, but sometimes you can get an opportunity. Actually, this big touch screen is behind this photographer's studio, so it's not the part of the visual, how do you call it, scenery of the exhibition, but even though you get a possibility to look through the to the different kind of places and also the how the front was developing and how the decisive battle in Tampere was fought, you can also find out all this information from the from this touchscreen multimedia. Throughout this exhibition, there are some unexpected experiences, like this installation of the rifles, which is partly hidden behind the wall, behind the multimedia touchscreen, and you get really surprised to get in front of the rifles in the middle of the exhibition. And this, along with these stories from the people, with these experiences of the people, they are really creating strong emotional feelings. And even though most of the stuff is authentic, we have been very careful also when we were doing this soundscape, that it's as authentic as possible. But in addition to that, we have also used these scenographic solutions like these dead bodies and coffins. Or destroyed home in Tampere. There's a very good photograph out of this showcase is on the floor. And the epilogue of the exhibition concentrates on the memory and the remembrance of the war, how it was dealt in statues, in films, in different kind of interpretations, and there is also some eyewitnesses like this 98-year-old Kauko Lindell, who is actually this small boy here, 10 years old, looking at the camera, and actually Kauko was over 90 years old when he found out that there is sort of this photograph is existing. And I interviewed Kauko in the spring 2008, and he was such a clear-minded with his experiences, like a child's experiences of the war. And it was very, very touching to hear all his stories. And unfortunately, he passed away only 3 months after that interview. In the very last section of the exhibition, of course, there is some discussion about the civil wars in the world, some comparison to the contemporary crisis. And of course, we are asking this question, whether it's still a trauma in Finland, in Tampere, whether we should continue this discussion about the civil war. And I really like to thank your attention, and you can look more thoroughly into the themes of the exhibition from this website, paprikki.net/Tampere 1918.